Welcome to Dental Shorts. Now we will try to solve 10 questions, and at the end of the question I will give you the key and its discussion in detail. The first question is, a patient complains of recent severe pain to percussion of a tooth. The most likely cause is options: acute periradicular periodontitis, chronic periradicular periodontitis, reversible pulpitis, irreversible pulpitis. So guess for, I'll give you 10 seconds, guess it, then we will move on to the second question. The second question is, the apical portion of the maxillary lateral incisor usually curves to the options, facial side, palatal or mesial or distal. So guess the answer. The third question is, during a non-vital bleaching procedure, if a barrier material is not placed between the root canal filling and the bleaching material, the tooth can be subjected to external cervical resorption, demineralization of the tooth structure, gingival inflammation, poor color improvement. Guess the answer. The fourth question is, the generally accepted maximum thickness of the composite increment that allows for proper cure is 1 to 2 mm, 2 to 4 mm, 4 to 6 mm. There is no maximum thickness restriction. Guess the answer. Fifth question, the third molar impaction most difficult to remove is vertical, mesioangular, distoangular, horizontal. The third molar impaction most difficult, guess it. Sixth question, in an adult of normal size, penetration to a depth of how many mm places the needle tip in the immediate vicinity of the foramen through which the posterior superior alveolar nerves enter the posterior surface of the maxilla? Options 10, 16, 20, 30. So they're just asking, for a normal adult person, how much penetration is needed, okay, so that the needle tip will be in close approximation with the foramen through which the posterior superior alveolar nerve enter the posterior surface of the maxilla. Guess the answer. So the seventh question is, a 7-year-old patient presents with a quadrant of teeth showing abnormal formation of both enamel and dentin. All of his other teeth appear clinically normal. Radiographically, The affected teeth can be described as ghost teeth. The patient has what? Regional odontodysplasia, dens evaginatus, dentin dysplasia, ectodermal dysplasia, cleidocranial dysplasia. Guess the answer. Eighth question. When using a cervical pull headgear, the forces generated on the maxillary first molar causes this teeth to move in which of the following ways? Mesially and to extrude, distally and to extrude, mesially and to intrude, distally and to intrude. Guess the answer. Explanation I will give you at the end of the video. Watch with the discussion. Ninth question. The willful failure of a parent or a guardian to seek and follow through with treatment necessary to ensure a level of oral health essential for adequate function and freedom from pain and infection is a definition of Munchausen syndrome by proxy, emotional abuse, parental corruption, neglect. Guess the answer. Tenth question. Order the process of tooth formation. So you have to properly sequence the order. Match each letter with its proper sequence number. So apposition, histodifferentiation, calcification, initiation, proliferation. In the proper sequence, you have to align it to the alphabet and the number. Now let's see the answers for all the 10 questions with detailed explanation. So the first question answer is acute periradicular periodontitis. Because in the question it is written recent severe pain. Recent means it would be an acute pain. So that you can easily say it's an A, may be the answer. And the second option, second clue you have is that is the percussion of the tooth. Severe pain on percussion. Whenever there is a pain in percussion, it would be related to the periodontal ligament. The inflammation has extended from the pulp to the periradicular area. So with the two clues, recent as well as percussion, you can easily say the answer is A, acute periradicular periodontitis. So the answer for this question, apical portion of the maxillary lateral incisor usually curves to the distal side. Why it is curving to the distal side is that about 50% of the maxillary lateral incisor root are towards the distal aspect. The tip will dilacerate to the distal aspect, 50%. So the answer would be distal. Okay, this is the one of the reason why the root canal treatment fails due to insufficient obturation in the apical region of the maxillary lateral incisor. So that is an additional point. For this question, it is distal is the answer. So whenever we are doing a non-vital bleaching procedure, a barrier material should be placed between the root canal filling and the bleaching material. It's at least should be 4 mm of interval between the root canal filling and the bleaching material. If it is not placed, that is the question, if it is not placed between the root canal filling and the bleaching material, the tooth can be subjected to external cervical resorption. According to the statistics, nearly 3.9% of the external cervical root resorption is due to bleaching. So, the 4 mm of distance between there should be there between the bleaching material and the root canal filling material to prevent the external root resorption, cervical root resorption. So, this external cervical root resorption can also be called as peripheral inflammatory root resorption. That is the extra point. Okay, so we will go to the next question. So whenever we are giving a composite restoration, it has to be placed in the increments. You couldn't place it bulkily because the polymerization has to occur properly. For the proper curing and polymerization of the composites, we need to place it incrementally. About 1 to 2 mm we have to keep and cure. Do not keep more than 2 mm. Okay, so the answer is 1 to 2 mm. So the most difficult third molar impaction is distoangular. Why distoangular? Because in this question they didn't specifically say whether it is a mandibular molar or a maxillary molar, but we consider it as a mandibular molar an answer. If they specifically say it is mandibular molar, then it will be very much clear it's distoangular, okay? Because the ramus of the mandible will be a hindrance, okay? The path of removal will be towards the ramus of the mandible. So, surgical intervention will be much more difficult in the distoangular case, okay? But the most easiest in the maxillary, if the question they specified as a third molar maxillary impaction, then the distoangular would be easier, okay? So remember that. We'll go to the next question. So this question is related to the posterior superior alveolar nerve block. Okay. So they're just confusing you, like immediate vicinity to the foramen and the posterior surface of the maxilla. These are all distracting terms. So it's simple as that. How much is the depth of penetration of the needle tip would be ideal for the posterior superior alveolar nerve block? That is the gist of this question. So the answer is 16 mm. Why 16 mm? Because it's only half of the long needle has to penetrate, okay, for the posterior superior alveolar nerve block. If you are using a short needle, then 3/4 of the needle length should penetrate, okay, that is 15 mm. So it would be around 15 to 16 mm would be the correct answer, okay. If 15 is there, you can write 15, because 3/4 of the short needle is 15 mm, okay. So, if you are not, what is the complication? That may be somewhere asked, so I am discussing it now itself. So, if you are going beyond 16 mm, what happens is that you will hit the vessel and there will be a positive aspiration. And even after the positive aspiration, if you are injecting it, then there will be a cause of hematoma formation. Okay? So, if you see this question, it says like 7-year-old patient presents with a quadrant of teeth showing abnormal formation of both enamel and dentin. Abnormal formation of both enamel and dentin. And all of the other teeth appears normal. Okay, so it is localized to a quadrant, not to the other teeth. So this is the second point got from the question. The third important point is ghost teeth. If you see a word ghost teeth, just go for regional odontodysplasia. Okay, the answer is regional odontodysplasia. Why not dense evaginators? In dense evaginators, there is only an extra cusp. Okay, it's not like the abnormal formation of enamel and dentin. It is an extra cusp on the cusp over the cusp. It's like that. Okay, and then dentin dysplasia, only dentin is affected, and there will be the tooth color will be remaining normal in dentin dysplasia. And as well as the pulp are obliterated with a very small space, residual space, which is called chevrons. Okay, dentin dysplasia is not the answer. Ectodermal dysplasia, you will only see a partial anodontia or complete anodontia. Okay, the tooth will not be present partially, or it complete absence of teeth will be there. In cleidocranial dysplasia, you will be seeing a supernumerary teeth, but there will be not like a abnormal formation of enamel and dentin. Okay, so the answer is regional odontodysplasia. So the next question is about the cervical pull headgear. The force is directed to the maxillary first molar, they have said. So how it is going to affect that molar? So if it is cervical pull, it's very logical. Okay, if you pull something from below, what does it happen? It just comes out, so extrude. So you can confine to A or B, and then you have to say whether it is coming mesially or distally. Okay, so always cervical pull headgear will pull back. Okay, so pull back when you give a force from the behind, that the neck, the tooth is going to obviously move distally. So it's going to move distally and extrude. The opposite to that is the high pull headgear. In high pull headgear, you will see distal movement with the intrusion, because the headgear will be placed in the occipital region. So it's above. So it's pulling from above, the maxillary tooth will intrude definitely. And also it will tip distally. So if that is a high pull headgear or occipital pull headgear, then it would be distally and intrude. In this case, they have asked for cervical pull headgear. So the answer is distally and extrude. So for this question, our answer is neglect, because the parent is knowingly and willingly does not seek care for the child who has a pain and infection. So it is a guilt of neglect. Okay. So when you come to the other options like Munchausen syndrome, that case it would be a person, usually a parent, present with fastidious symptoms and illness in a children, which may result in extensive testing and hospitalization. Coming to the next option, that is emotional abuse. Emotional abuse, it would be like denial of affection, isolation, extreme threat, corruption. So this would be example of emotional abuse. So that is not the answer. Okay. So the answer would be, it was not a parental corruption also. So the answer is neglect. So the answer is easily remembered by a mnemonic called IPAC. Okay. IPAC means IPHAC, that is initiation, proliferation, histodifferentiation, apposition, calcification. So IPAC is the mnemonic for remembering the sequence of tooth formation. So if you like the video of Dental Shorts, kindly subscribe to our channel. And if you want the notification for further updates on new videos, kindly subscribe. And give a comment how you feel about this video below. Thank you.